Do you want to be my friend? I want to be your friend. We're going to be best pals. Rent-A-Pal is brought to us by director John Stevenson and stars Brian Landis Fulkins and Will Wheaton. We follow David, played by Fulkins, a lonely bachelor who cares for his ailing mother in 1990. David's not one that you would call savvy with the ladies. I mean, the whole mid-30-somethings living in your mom's basement thing's probably not helping him out too much either. So because of this, he is part of what's called a video dating service. It's kind of like internet dating sites before the internet. You would essentially record a video of yourself talking about what you like, the things you do, trying to sell yourself to someone. Not actually, but you know, trying to let people know, hey, this is who I am. If you're interested, swipe right. Other people view these videos. If they like you, they check something off or call or swipe right or whatever it is they did back then. I can't remember. Unsurprising to no one, David doesn't really get a lot of hits when it comes to this service. And times is a bit low. David's feeling pretty down because all his life consists of is hanging out in his basement, watching videos, jerking off, and then taking care of his ailing mother upstairs. But one day, he discovers a videotape called Rent-A-Pal. He takes this video home and watches it, and what do you know, it's like a friend on the TV. It's a video of a guy who's just sitting there talking directly to the camera, asking you questions, and giving you kind of canned responses to the things you could be saying. Yeah, it's pretty fucking sad, but hey, that's where the guy is, and if it helps him get out of this rut, more power to him. And yeah, I guess it does help him get out of this rut, but it kind of puts him in a whole new rut. We quickly see that not everything is okay here. Something's not quite right about this thing. This pal on the tape, John, played by Will Wheaton, starts to become a bit aggressive when it comes to certain subjects. And it seems like some of his answers and responses to David are a little bit too on the nose. And when David finally gets a hit at his video dating service and ends up spending more and more time with this woman he's met, it seems like John, yes, John, the guy in the tape, doesn't really like this too much. And then things get pretty out there as we start to see that not everything is as it seems with the Rent-A-Pal tape. Rent-A-Pal is a psychological thriller that is really fucking twisted at times. Now, while the story I just explained seems a bit odd, the way that it's portrayed in the film isn't as odd as you would think. Now, don't get me wrong, there's some really weird shit in this movie, but it's not like that really off-kilter, odd kind of weird like I made it sound a moment ago. No, it's a much more menacing kind of odd. The big question throughout the movie is this tape actually a supernatural force, or is this going on in David's head? We don't ever really know throughout the film, and that was one of the greatest things about it. You're wondering, is this tape actually demented and taking this guy over? Or is this guy just a stark raving mad fucking lunatic? Honestly, within the confines of this story and world, either one are believable. The things that are on the tape and the way that it's presented to us do offer up a very compelling reason as to why this might be a supernatural story. However, all the stuff that David has going on in his life also offers up a compelling reason as to why this guy may have lost his fucking mind. And that was one of the things that made the movie really interesting. You never really know, which is it? And once we get to the end of the movie, you do more or less get a definitive answer. There is a part of it that's a little bit left open to interpretation, but I think that the movie gives you enough to give you an answer to which is which. Speaking of the end of this movie, that shit escalates real fucking quick. This is a more psychological type of movie. The thrills here are definitely here, but they're very slow, methodical, and psychological. Until the end, the last quarter of this movie goes pretty off the fucking rails and takes all that's built up throughout the film and just unleashes it. And it is very satisfying. The buildup of this movie is done very well. It keeps it all really interesting from beginning to end. But like I said about the ending, it doesn't just cop out. It gives you a payoff that you've been waiting for this entire time. Overall, the story and execution were very well done, and I had a really good time with this movie, though it did leave me at times feeling a bit disturbed. Our performances here are what really sell this whole deal. This is very much a slower paced type of thriller. There is lots of menacing tone here and not so much stuff happening on screen. Till the end, that is, when shit just goes fucking batshit insane. And seeing as how the movie does move at such a slower pace, you gotta have some really good performances to carry it all. Thankfully, between Brian Landis Fulkins, Will Wheaton, and Amy Rutledge, we have a great cast here. Wheaton and Fulkins in particular totally sell this movie. Falcon's David is just a sad slop that you just can't stop watching. I didn't so much relate with the character, but I did relate with how he felt about the situation he was in. And he seemed like a genuinely nice guy that you wanted to succeed, but just shit kept happening. It kept piling up on top of the guy. And from that perspective, I think a lot of people can relate with that. This guy does have it real bad though. Now, Wheaton's John is a bit of a different beast. This entire character is very off-putting, but he's supposed to be. From the first second you see this character, you know something's not quite right. It's clear that his Mr. Rogers-esque demeanor is masking something much more sinister. And that's a great word for Wheaton's performance here, is sinister, menacing. These kind of threatening words, that's what he puts out here, and he does it brilliantly. This is one of the most understated, sinister roles that I've ever seen. And I couldn't really imagine anyone else besides Will Wheaton in the part. On the surface, everything seems perfect. He seems like a super great chipper guy, but there's a fucking devil or something lurking in there, and you can see it from the first moment. And Wheaton does a fantastic job of projecting that out to us, the viewers. I mean, really, he does a wonderful job here as this character. The next time David Fincher decides to make like a creepy serial killer movie, he needs to hire Will Wheaton as the killer, and he'll have a fucking hit on his hand. Overall, while it is a limited cast, the performances that we do get are all fantastic. From the technical side, everything's good here too. The look of the film is very 90s. It feels like this is a 1990s movie. Not just that it took place in 1990. You don't even have to be told what year it is. When the film starts, you can automatically tell this is not now, this is somewhere in the early 90s. Maybe late 80s. They did a very good job of projecting you to this time period. As far as special effects go, there's not a whole lot here. There are a few small effects, more camera trickery here or there, but for the most part, what you got in camera is what you got. Now we do get some practical gore effects closer to the end, and those are all really well done too. Although they do lean more on the realistic side, so it's not just geysers of blood all over the place. This isn't like a Gorehound's dream or anything, but that's not the vibe that this movie was going for anyway. What's here is very believable, realistic, and pretty good all around. Guys, I don't want to say too much more about Rent-A-Pal because I don't want to ruin it. What I will say about it is I had a really good time with this movie. It's a really interesting story, some great performances, and one of the most low-key sinister characters I've ever seen on film. The movie will make you feel uncomfortable at times, but that is what it was going for. And with all that and the very satisfying end that we get to it all, Rent-A-Pal is absolutely worth a rent.
All he wanted was, hey, this.
You have to return some videotape.
The irony of Rent-A-Pal being worth a rent is not lost on me. But yes, the movie is worth a rent. You're probably only going to want to watch it once, but that one time is going to be a great watch. So there it is, guys, my review of Rent-A-Pal. If you enjoyed and want more content like this, hit that subscribe button and help my little channel grow. If you liked what I had to say, give me a like. If not, let me know in the comments below why. And as always, stay sexy, Sacramento.
When all the chips are down,
you've taken everything from me.
Some of you may look at the premise of this movie and think, oh, well, that's kind of high concept. But no, it's not. These kinds of things actually existed. These video dating services were very much a real thing. And even the Rent-A-Pal tape, while they may not have been called Rent-A-Pal, there were tapes out there that would talk to you and kind of hold these faux conversations with you. Now, if they were to the extent of the one in this movie, I don't know, but I do know that they existed. I saw them before. Not like I saw them. I didn't like watch them, but I've seen them somewhere. I can't remember where, but I knew they existed back in the day, and I thought they were pretty fucking weird then too. I mean, hey, do what you gotta do to make it through life, I guess. Who am I to judge? But come on, man. I mean, watching a video of a guy who's just sitting there talking directly to the camera like he's talking to you, telling you things like you guys are having a face-to-face conversation, and then giving you answers and asking you questions, I mean, that's fucking insane, right?